Now I just want to go get my hair done. I swear to God, I want this asshole more than I want anything. I'm feeling so eccentric. I'm feeling so motherland right now. I am feeling motherland. What's your name?
Shaka.
Why are you
excused?
Yeah, well,
the New York
train is the వద్దు బేట నో 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 అంకుల్ ఎప్పుడు మన పాప
వస్తారే వస్తాడు
డోర్ ఇయర్ బేట గో టెల్ 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 కర్ మన లో ఇట్ కోన రూమ్
So think about it or
No.
The instructions?
Yeah.
I think this is single file against the wall.
If you're injured, stay against the wall or something like that.
Okay.
I'll come for you later.
They're going to see you in the most
people. Just stay in a single file, all right? As best you can. Yep, you'll be fine.
Thanks a lot.
All right, thank you.
All right, guys, you'll be off the train shortly. Listen up. You're going to exit the train, all right, and you're going to stay against the wall, all right? If you have a medical condition, immediately exit the train, stay to the right. We'll get you help. We have people standing by, all right? If you have no medical issues, exit the train against the wall, single file and orderly, okay?
Thank you very much.
This is floor 3, right?
Yeah.
New York Sergeant Pat, so floor 5, 6, 4, number 3 center.
Any injury, just step over to the side.
Can you come back and play under my shirt?
Am I getting a new ticket? Am I getting a new ticket?
No picture, sir. Put your camera away, please.
Thanks for your patience.
Oh, we're already in there, right?
Yeah, there's nothing to see here.
Okay, sure.
Thank you.
No, I don't know.
You don't know, come on. You know what's going on, right? You just don't want to say?
That's a good one, right?
We should get stuck in the subway for 45 minutes there. We had to walk through the tunnel.
Yeah. What train?
Fast train.
Fast train is stuck?
Yeah, no, no train.
I can't. Am I stuck?
Bless you. Bless you.
This is a freaking market.
Oh my God.
Excuse me.
Thank you.
tell me what you're doing?
We're setting up an altar for missing, murdered, and trafficked women.
Nice, nice, nice.
It's for the 16 days of women of activism against gender violence. So it's an Affirm NY project.
It's a what?
Affirm New York.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that an organization?
Yes. It's the Association of Filipinas Feminists Fighting Against Imperialism, Refutalization, and Marginalization.
And how old is that organization?
It's over 20 years old. Hmm. That's what I
mean. And those are the...
those are the women.
Some of the women?
Some of the women.
How many cases are you presenting here?
For Olivia.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So let's get that.
Yeah.
Let's just trust.
We don't have to.
But someone could carry the banner, missing murders.
You mean not allowed to have it on the ground?
Yes. Well, it's just needed.
That's fine.
It's not a fix. This is a place though. Or
thank you. Where are all these women?
Also
where are all these women from?
All over the world. I mean, so everyone in this group has different issues. They're more attached to. For me, I did a lot of work doing shows related to the missing women of Juarez, where many women were killed in the maquiladoras on the border of Mexico. There's a lot of women being trafficked all over the world, in South America, in Mexico, in the Philippines, in the United States. All the girls here have different groups that they work with, but this is actually a firm, the group right now, that is promoting.
Any one of those?
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's probably why the lighting, maybe if you take a chalk this right there. Yeah. I was like not happy with my pictures.
All the names before they tell us that we're not allowed to chalk.
They did?
Yeah, once they were telling us, like, oh, you can't attach here. Like, well, good job to do because they want to make a point. You have to get it to the point. And they come back and tell us that we can't have the chalk now, so we have to hold it.
Thank you. I'm gonna be in my own film. I just did the first one.
Okay.
Thank you. You think of filling the square?
We'll see how far.
He didn't say no. And
yeah.
this guy there didn't say no, right?
I know.
What's his name?
We're just gonna keep on going back.
Who is he?
Abe Lincoln.
Abe Lincoln, right? So he's for emancipation of some kind.
Yeah. It works out. It works perfectly. He's looking over us.
Are you holding it up? Princess, are you holding that up?
I'm making it look like I am.
Chalk the name. We have the list here.
But thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. just started doing it on their own. They haven't come back around yet.
Okay, what's your name?
Olivia Canlis.
And tell me about the organization and today's event.
So we're part of a national organization.
The firm New York City?
Yes. It's a local chapter of a national organization, but we're a transnational feminist organization, anti-imperialist. So the acronym is Against Imperialism, Refeudalization, and Marginalization. So today's action is to commemorate the missing, murdered, trafficked women here in the United States and throughout the world. There are over 64,000 missing black women here in the United States, 1,200 or more missing or murdered Aboriginal and Indigenous women in Canada, and then trafficked women from Indonesia, Philippines, Korea. One of the stories that we tried to commemorate here was the Comfort Women, which were actually military sex slaves that were used by the Japanese Imperial Army during World War II, mostly Korean and Indonesian and Filipina women. So that's why we're here today. We decided to try to take up some public space with the names of these women that have been missing, murdered, or trafficked. So that's why we're here.
And what are you asking the people to do?
So this is part of the 16 days of women's activism, and we're here basically trying to bring awareness and raise consciousness around.
How you doing, sir?
This is day number one, or day, what today is?
So it started on November 25th, and November 25th is actually in commemoration of the day that the Mirabal sisters in the Dominican Republic were assassinated by the Trujillo regime for political reasons. So right now we're in the last day is December 10th.
Okay. Looks like the park services doesn't want you to be here.
No.
They keep on telling us to take stuff off the ground and we have to hold it. So our solution to that is to write to our email.
A lot of calls not to move. Natural.
There's no door, no way.
How'd you get in?
How did you get in the city?
How we get in the city?
Yeah. Everybody should have a right to go and read what's on it. That's the history of the country.
Absolutely.
Thomas Jefferson is on it. I saw it.
Yep.
Have a good one, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
not here yet.
Yeah.
Well, maybe I should be here.
Transporter into Canada, where 1,500 First Nations
and Aboriginal women have disappeared along a road conferred the title of a Highway of Tears. From the foregoing data, it is clear that our current social order has failed and continues to fail women of color, Native and Aboriginal women. Affirm therefore asks everyone to keep in mind the following. When you speak of poverty, remember that the poorest of the poor in every community is a woman. When you speak of exploitation, remember that the lowest paid is a woman. When you speak of violence, remember that violence against women is pandemic. When you speak of liberation, remember that the one with the greatest need and use for it is a woman.
Embarrassment from the passerby. They don't really know what to do.
Yes, and that's why a lot of these names have been kept hidden, because people don't know what to do about it. And so the families are left grieving on their own or trying to find these women on their own. Police not doing anything, federal government is not doing anything, you know, and it's taken almost 20 years, for instance, to push the Canadian government to look for the 1,500 missing native Canadians. It's ridiculous. In this day and age, to have 60,000 black women missing in the United States, how is that possible?
And typically when they find out what happens to them, what happens to be the case, what type of things happen to them.
Nobody's looking except for the families. And so these women have been missing, some for decades. The persistent report is that they have been trafficked. And you know, when you're trafficked into the sex trade, after a certain period of time, you're no longer of value. And so you're either dumped somewhere or killed.
Do you see any sort of complicity on the part of the governments?
Oh, absolutely, especially with this current push to legalize prostitution as part of the neoliberal so-called, expansion of capitalist freedom. They have managed to reduce the concept of feminism to a choice feminism, ignoring all the social structures that actually work against women.
And is this mostly poor women that are concerned by this kind of crime, I guess we have to call it? This is like an international crime?
It is an international crime. For instance, among Asia Pacific Islander women, one of the highest causes of death is suicide. You know, and you can see why the situation is so bad for them. From the fact that a large percentage of those who are trafficked into the sex trade in the U.S. come from the Asia and Pacific region.
And who are these people who do the trafficking? What sort of people?
All kinds. Well, we know the pimps in the corner, that's all we see. But in actuality, I'm very sure there are ultra-rich people who are doing this, you know. The tourist industry, for instance, you cannot, like, have tourism without trafficking.
You're speaking like cases like Thailand?
Thailand, the entire economy is dependent on prostitution. What kind of country would that situation would that be for women? When your entire national economy is dependent on prostitution. And this goes for the Philippines. The entire economy is dependent on labor export. Every day we see reports of our women who are in domestic servitude in the Middle East being killed, being abused, and so on. This is like 3 reports per day.
What are the worst countries where the trafficking occurs as far as the destinations and the prostitution?
The United States is the number one destination for trafficking, probably because of the dollar value, yeah? But the source, one of the worst sources of trafficked women is just across the border in Mexico. There is a little town that exists on nothing but trafficking women, and mostly from Central America. So you have kids there, about 20% of the kids in that village, the dream is to be a pimp when they grow up. what kind of culture are we creating under neoliberal imperialist globalization?
Maybe speaking about New York, for instance, there used to be a lot of open street prostitution on the west side, on 42nd Street and other areas of the town.
Yeah.
But we see fewer and fewer of these. As a matter of fact, it's kind of hard to see. So where is this now happening, this trafficking? What is the condition of trafficking now?
They are usually in the outlying boroughs, in the neighborhoods of immigrants and migrants. Yeah. You can go to Queens, for instance, and there is a place there called the Vaseline Alley. This is where...
what street is that? Somewhere in Queens.
Yes. This is where all the traffic boys are taken. Yeah. And then you can go down to Flushing, you can see the shoulder to shoulder massage parlors, nail salons, and so on. Not all of them, but a lot of them are fronts for prostitution.
So now it has sort of moved inside houses and hiding behind legitimate
Correct.
Businesses.
Correct. Then we have this problem of very young women who are going to college, and when they cannot pay the tuition, they go into, they're recruited for the strip clubs, the nightclubs, the brothel houses. It's a major, major issue.
Are there a lot of underage women as well?
Very, very many.
Now, how does an underage woman go through a border if she's not accompanied by an adult? Is this there's some complicity within the family, or are they just working? Are they just traveling with an adult that they don't know? What typically happens?
Oh, across the border, there have been so many minors who have been crossing the border.
Illegally?
Yes.
From Mexico?
From Mexico. And this is very, very dangerous. I mean, these kids are told, your parents are waiting for you on the other side, you know, and then they end up somewhere. But the thing is that this is a business that thrives on demand. On the assumed right of men to have access on the bodies of the poor, the vulnerable, the young, and the powerless. This is a privilege which has been enshrined for 10,000 years, and we have to end this now. We understand that there are people who are forced into the sex trade because they have no option. So the decision to enter the sex trade is very often not a choice. It is from lack of a choice.
What would you propose that would be should be changed as a first thing to bring some reduction in these horrible numbers?
I think we should decriminalize the selling of sex, decriminalize it, and criminalize the buying of sex, so that the power will rest on those who sell and not on those who buy.
Right, I see that. So even though women would sell, but somebody would say maybe they could be set up into something that they don't really want to do.
Yes. So to make sure,
right,
to make sure that this is a matter of her decision, even if her, if not her choice, you know, that she is protected in making that decision. But the man whose privilege this has been for like 10,000 years should not be protected. We would like to ban Johns, We would like to ban pimps. We would like to ban brothel houses. So that the business, you know, side of prostitution is not given the power, but rather the practice of it is given the power.
Do you think this is practical? Is there, are there places where they've tried to,
They have done this in Norway. It's called the Nordic model, actually. And prostitution has dropped by 80% in the country. But this is not just by itself. It is an entire package. You do that and you offer programs, you know, and you offer jobs and so on to the women so that they are not constrained to make a decision that is based on a lack of choices.
Why do you think men are going to prostitutes?
I have no idea. I would like, could you answer that?
I guess somebody should ask them, right?
This is a question. Nobody asks the men why they do it. They're always asking the women why they're in prostitution. Nobody has done a study of the guys. From the women in the sex trade I have spoken to, it's a question of power.
That's what they're saying.
Yes. For the men.
It's a form of domination or...
power.
Power.
Yeah, because you can buy something and afflict it with whatever you want.
It's a control thing, right?
Yeah.
So this man may be needing... it's sort of a form of a sickness that's due to the society, or is it something in the nature of men that that needs to be repressed? What would be your guess on that?
I think it's a question, this is just speculation on my part, but I think prostitution is used as a form of alleviation of alienation. When men are alienated and powerless, they need to afflict somebody with power so as to not feel so alienated. And unfortunately, the women being the poorest of the poor and the most vulnerable.
I met a woman one time, a very long time ago, and that's when I was a young business person. And she's, you know, we sat down. She was a dancer, but I know she was also doing some prostitution on the side. And I asked her, I said, why are you doing this? And what she said is basically, well, I could go and work in an office for the rest of my life and just make very low wages and being abused. And by doing this, it's not that different, but at least I make some money.
It is different, I think. There is a big difference between massaging an office keyboard and massaging a man's genitals.
That's true.
There's a big difference. Okay, people like to say there's no difference. There is. I should know that. Good Lord. But the thing is that the lowest paid jobs are the ones which are offered to women.
Those are the worst jobs, like cleaning and the, you know, tiring and cleaning. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Of choice, it is a matter of agency. No, not until everything is equal in this world can we talk about consent, free will, and choice. For the moment, we are still fighting.
You feel like women are not getting a shot at getting well-paid jobs in general? Obstacles to that? Is this just give me a mechanism on how these things happen, because when people apply for a job, they typically have a very variety of candidates. Is this your idea that, you know, they are not getting the job because they're women and people consider them to be less capable of doing the same job, or maybe they get the job but because they're getting paid less. So
Gibbs burst workers. Who takes care of them until they're good enough to work? It's the women. That's why women will not be offered good jobs. Because they have to take care of the next generation of workers for free. For free. This is the unpaid, stolen labor of women under every form of class society. Every form, from slavery to this time.
So you think women should stop having children?
That would be fantastic, I think. Actually, there was in Nairobi at the first international conference of women under the UN, some Indian feminists proposed a 10-year moratorium on having children. So we kind of laughed at it until we did the mathematics. The system will collapse.
The system would collapse, you said?
Yes. Because 10 years, then you have children, 15 years to raise the children, that's 25 years. Where are you going to get your workers?
So,
that's a quarter
so children,
of a century.
We need children to continue.
Yeah. The corporations need children.
The corporations?
Yeah.
But human society in general doesn't?
It does. But the corporations need 15-year-olds. To hire, to work.
So if some benefits would be given to women for raising children?
It should be.
Some sort of social security or pension?
More than that.
To raise children?
I think the raising of children should be a social responsibility. We should have a national daycare program. Schools for children should be for free, ipso facto, instead of this.
Actually, there are countries in Europe that are that way, right?
Yes. And then I know in Montreal, daycare is like $2 an hour or something.
So you feel like there's less pressure on women in Quebec or Canada for, as far as getting jobs and getting at least as much income as men?
Less, but also not yet equal. And it depends on what kind of woman. If we're talking about the First Nations of Canada, that's the women of the First Nations, that's totally different.
They're not getting benefits?
He's Canadian, First Nations, talk to him. He knows more than I do. Steve! He's asking me about the First Nations of Canada, the women there. You talk to him.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Steve.
Hi.
There's some questions of any difference or differential in the condition and treatment of women, indigenous women in Canada versus the rest of the population. That was my question to Ninochka, but she says you might have some insights into this.
I'm not an expert on the numbers, statistics. Just in terms of being a Canadian living there, growing up there, you know, in a household of five sisters, and watching them, you know, struggle with being Indigenous, Native American, the struggles they have, you know, in their homes, getting employment, raising their families, and having to face like the racism that, you know, being a Native American and growing up in Canada, living in Canada, it's a tough struggle.
Did they live on the reservation?
Yes, I did. I grew up in northern Canada, in what's called the Pasquiak Cree Nation. And we have an on-reserve population of almost 3,000 and almost half that living off reserve. So.
And how do people survive there?
They survive, but the economy, like everywhere else, it's really bad. So jobs are scarce. The major employer is the tribe itself, the administration. There are some infrastructure, like a school, public services, but mostly it's the, we have a mall on the reserve, so that's the major employer for both on reserve and off reserve.
And then a lot of government subsidies goes into, I guess, the government of the tribe, or how do they finance?
It's actually funded like any government agency every number of years, like 4 years. They have to sign up for and apply for a contribution agreement. And with those funds, they can fund like social services, things like that. But we're trying to build an economy using the mall as a prime resource of money to build things that we need on the reserve.
So young women facing with, I guess, massive unemployment, and I guess young men as well, but what is their response to the situation they find themselves in? Do they tend to want to stay there or move to other locations within the general population to try to take a chance and survive there?
There's been a recent trend with education successes in our community, where a lot of our Aboriginal women, Indigenous women, are staying home in their communities, but the majority do go and migrate to urban areas for employment, advancement. But a lot of times, the employment on reserves is pretty bleak. So the jobs are in cities, so that's where the people go.
And is all the land on the reservations reserved for the people who live there, or can actually outsiders come in and set up business as well? Because that's the case, I believe, in the United States. They give them people, ways to establish themselves and do business. But
each community up in Canada is kind of different. They're unique in their administration, how they run their affairs. So I can't say, across the country, like which tribes do what. So our tribe, they try to promote other officer businesses to come in and start up shop, but we tend to try to do it ourselves.
So tribal people tend to try to solve their problem internally, or is there some sort of dialogue and communication and coordination among the tribes to recognize that there's similar problems, and also do they address the specific problems of women?
I'll give you an example. Over this past winter or last winter, we had a problem with some internal stuff on the tribe, in the tribe itself. And what happened was the women on our First Nation, we call them First Nations in Canada, we saw these women form a group within themselves to address this problem. And that's what recent events have kind of forced their hand, not leaving it up to leadership to take care of things. They're gathering and meeting and uniting to solve problems themselves.
A community of women, basically.
Yes, exactly. So it's women leading. And that's like basically the premise of Idle No More. That grassroots movement that started in Canada was started by women. So women are basically coming in and starting to lead.
In the basic form, though, isn't it true that there were in the tribes
societies of women, that men and women had sort of different societies traditionally, and that they had, I guess they are communally. I don't know. I'm just asking if that's the case.
Again, it's kind of different, kind of unique to each nation, mm-hmm. to each tribe. Some are matriarchal, mm-hmm. where the women clans run, you know, used to run and decide and make major decisions pre-contact. Mm-hmm. But with...
Is that the case in your tribe?
Not... That's what I mean. With this event this past winter, you know, the women mm-hmm. gathered and decided, we can't leave it up to leadership, which is basically mostly men, patriarchal still. But the women decided, we're going to take care of this. And enacted an old adage where women were the leaders and made decisions.
So do you know how the idea came about?
I think a lot of it was influenced by that Idle No More movement that began in 2012. They saw it happening across the nation. They saw it happening in communities, urban, res, rural. So they kind of got encouraged to speak up.
It's a women's movement.
Exactly. Well, I'm not going to say not just women, but it was led by women. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Steve.
You're
very
welcome.
Instructive.
You're
Thank
welcome. You. The spirits of ceremony predict the mystic day when she can say something that the world can't ignore. Maybe we overlooked her before, but now she has the floor. So listen as she explores the core right off the mighty shore of something more of what seems like it's only found in her dreams. Love, like Father Sky up above. It's the love she feels. She knows this. Yeah, this is real. No one can steal her self-acceptance and self-love. No one will ever shove her to the bitter edge. Yup. Right up to the dark and lonely ledge, because her spirit soared and she became more than what she endured.
I brought the cord also, like I brought like, the cord.
Shortly before 5 o'clock, at the end of classes before Christmas break, 14 female engineering students were shot and killed at Ecole Polytech in Montreal, Quebec, by a gunman who claimed he was fighting feminism, end quote. The massacre stands as one of the most tragic hate crimes in Canadian history. That day, we remember Genevieve Bergeron, age 21, Helen Colgan, age 23, Natalie Croteau, age 23, Barbara Dagnino, 22, Anne-Marie Edward, 21, Maud Havernick, 29, Barbara Maria Klusnick, 31, Marie LeClaire, 23, Annie St. Arnault, 23, Michelle Richard, 21, Marie Lagunier, 25, Anne-Marie Lernay, 22, Sonia Pelletier, 28, and Annie Turcot, age 21. Mass shooting, feminicide.
Doing like churches.
What's your name?
Josephine Martin. There's a number to call there. Family has no clue about where she is, what happened with her. She's just missing. Disappeared.
How old was she?
52. There's a Crime Stoppers, there's a number there to call anonymously. If anybody has any tips for the family.
And this is only 2 weeks old?
Yes. This was in 1972, I believe.
She was kidnapped?
Kidnapped, taken, and you know, the men were looking for somebody to like, party with, and she was taken outside the town and murdered.
And did they ever find out who did this?
It took 20 years for, don't quote me on that, but it took a long time for the actual charges to be laid. The town knew who did it, the murderers, but kept it a secret. It was called the Conspiracy of Silence. There's a book about
the town
it.
Nearby. So there was a book that was written about
book
this.
Book about it, and there's a movie made about it. And she was instrumental. The case was instrumental in having an Aboriginal justice inquiry started in the early 90s, where organized. You know, inquiry is basically to see the uneven numbers in terms of how Aboriginal Native American people are treated by the justice system. And she was instrumental.
In, you know, the case was instrumental in bringing that about.
Exactly.
Yes, sir. Yes. 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 Yes Thank you. a firm 16 days of activism commemorates missing, murdered, and trafficked women. Let's talk about a young student who was murdered last year in 2014. Tuxte Albayrak. She was a German student of Turkish descent who aspired to be an English elementary school teacher. In the morning of November 15, 2014, Tuxte Albayrak was fatally beaten in a parking lot outside of a McDonald's restaurant. She intervened in a situation between three men and two young girls aged 13 and 16 after hearing the girls screaming in the toilet. She was then followed to her car and was sustained fatal head injuries by one of the men. In November 28, Tuxte's parents decided to turn off her life support machine after she was proclaimed brain dead. She died on her 23rd birthday. This woman was violently beaten to death for helping two girls while they were being harassed. So don't tell me women have nothing to be scared about. She is a hero. Rest in peace. Tuxte Albayrak.
Repeatedly struck in the head. She died at Harlem Hospital days after. tens of thousands have been consigned by the unholy connivance of state indifference, predators, and race and gender exploiters. Some 60,000 black women are missing in the U.S., a number which leaves both federal and state agencies unperturbed on the assumption that the women and girls have run away despite persistent reports of their being trafficked into the sex trade. For the Hispanic community, homicide is the fourth leading cause of death among females of the age of 1 to 9 and 15 to 24, while suicide tops homicide in the age of 10 to 14. Suicide substitutes for homicide among Asian Americans and Pacific Islander women. It is the second leading cause of death among AAPI women aged 15 to 34, and the third leading cause of death among girls aged 24 to 30. The intensity of gender oppression that creates such a high rate of suicide may be gleaned from the fact that the Asia and Pacific regions are the source for a large percentage of persons trafficked to the United States. Almost half of the trafficked women are for the sex trade, while 27% end in domestic servitude. The missing, murdered, and trafficked also affects indigenous women grievously. Native American and Native Alaskan women are prone to experience violence at 2 times the rate for women of other races. 34% will be raped in their lifetime. In some reservations, women were murdered at 10 times the national average rate. This culture of violence is inflicted upon Native and Aboriginal women trans border. Into Canada, where 1,500 First Nation and Aboriginal women have disappeared along a road conferred the title of a Highway of Tears. From the foregoing data, it is clear that our current social order has failed and continues to fail women of color, Native and Aboriginal women. Affirm, therefore ask everyone to keep in mind the following. When you speak of poverty, remember that the poorest of the poor in every community is a woman. When you speak of exploitation, remember that the lowest paid is a woman. When you speak of violence, remember that violence against women is a pandemic. When you speak of liberation, remember that the one with the greatest need and use for it is the woman.